Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Tote Bags and Tote Tags by Dorothy Howell. Narrated by Em Eldridge. Chapter 1. A whole new me. That's what I wanted. Not that there was anything wrong with the old me, really, but there had been some comments, a few whispers, an occasional eyebrow bob in my direction, a couple of, well, anyway, a whole new me seemed in order. After a run of not so great luck, long story, I knew I had to turn things around. So I did, big time. I'd finally figured out, for now anyway, what to do about the fact that, at age 24, my life was almost gone, and I hadn't accomplished much. Jeez, 30 wasn't that far away, and everybody knew it was all downhill after 30. So I, Haley Randolph, with my red carpet-worthy dark hair, my enviable 5'9" height, and my even-though-they're-mostly-recessive beauty queen jeans, had taken a giant leap forward in improving my life. Even without that flash of brilliance, my personal things were going great category looked pretty good, despite that patch of bad luck. I'd scored a huge chunk of change, long story, that kept me from roaming the parking lots at malls, asking total strangers for handouts. Not that I would have actually done that, but still. My best friend, Marcy Hanover, and I were giving killer purse parties and raking in the bucks. I had a fantastic apartment in Santa Clarita, about 30 minutes, give or take, from Los Angeles, that I'd fixed up just the way I wanted and absolutely loved. Of course, my personal things were not going so great category was stacked kind of high, too. I still had my crappy part-time job at the crappy Holtz department store, bringing down a crappy $7 an hour. And the crappiest part was that the store management actually wanted me to wait on customers. I mean, really, come on. How much could they expect for minimum wage? I was still slogging my way through college. The fall semester would begin in a few weeks, and I'd have to register soon. I saw no need to overwhelm myself with a full load of classes, or even a couple of classes. The one I'd picked out of the college catalog was plenty. And then, of course, there was my official boyfriend, Ty Cameron. I wasn't sure which category he belonged in. A few weeks ago, Ty practically put the smackdown on me to move in with him. He'd made all sorts of fabulous, and I mean totally fabulous, promises. But, well, let's just say we're still living apart, and neither of us has mentioned it since. Not even on our flight home from Las Vegas. I whipped my Honda into the parking lot a block off Figueroa Street in downtown Los Angeles, paid the attendant, and slid into a space near the entrance. The lot was packed, which wasn't unusual, and I was running late, which wasn't unusual either. I was meeting Marcy for lunch. She had a job at one of the banks on Fig, as everybody called it, in the financial district. She wouldn't mind that I was late. That's what good friends we were. By the time I hoofed it a block to Fig, the office buildings had already let out for lunch. The thing about downtown LA is that anything goes, fashion-wise. Some women were decked out in full-on business suits and pumps. Others went for a trendier look. Still others dressed comfortably. Men had it easier, of course. It's hard to go wrong with a suit and tie, sport jacket and crew neck sweater, or even a tie and shirt with the sleeves rolled back. Up the block, I spotted Marcy coming out of the bank building where she worked. She looked great in a Donna Karan suit. I had on sandals, a yellow top, and check out my butt, white capris. "I'm starving," Marcy said as I walked up. "Let's go to—" "Oh my God, what happened?" After only one quick look at my face, Marcy knew I had major news. See what good friends we were? Not that I'm a drama queen, or think that I'm all that, but moments such as this required a certain amount of hesitation to allow the suspense to build. But right now, I couldn't hold back. "I passed!" I screamed. Marcy grabbed my arm. "You passed? Already?" "Yes," I told her, and broke into my own personal X-rated Snoopy dance. A guy in a convertible stopped at the traffic signal, honked. I threw one last booty pop his way, and he drove off. "Wow, Haley, you said you were turning your life around, and you really have," Marcy said. In her official capacity as my best friend, Marcy had been the only person privy to my life-changing declaration of a few weeks ago. Plus, I didn't want a lot of people to know if I couldn't pull it off and ended up falling on my face. "How are you doing on your other changes?" Marcy asked. "Best friends can really be a mood spoiler sometimes." Okay, the whole new me idea wasn't exactly my idea. A few weeks ago, I met a girl who was kind of weird and, honestly, not all that bright. I didn't really like her. She got on my nerves big time. But she'd yammered on about how easy it was to change your life. She called it the reverse world. If you didn't like how things were going, just do the opposite. So that's what I'd done. "Things are going good," I told Marcy. "Really good." She gave me her, "I'm your best friend, so don't lie to me" look. I hate that look. "I'm working on them," I told her. In retrospect, maybe I'd overreached on some of the changes in my life, like not eating chocolate and laying off the mocha frappuccinos, the best drink in the entire world, from Starbucks. "When was the last time you had a Snickers bar?" Marcy asked. Jeez, having a best friend this good was kind of getting on my nerves all of a sudden. I hadn't expected her to really hold me accountable for my actions or anything. So, what could I do but change the subject? "I got a certificate," I said. "Want to see it?" "Sure." I dug into my totally fabulous Chanel tote and pulled out the certificate I'd earned after passing my final test. As of this morning, I was a graduate of UM, the University of Mixology, bartending school. "Look," I said, pointing. "It has a gold seal on it and everything." Marcy nodded appreciatively. "Cool, Haley, really cool." "Yeah, okay. I knew bartending school wasn't something I'd ever considered before. But life wasn't going the way I wanted, so I'd taken this drastic step to change things. UM seemed like a natural for me. After all, who would make a better bartender than someone like me, who loved to party? I went to all the best clubs. I knew lots of people there, and everyone knew me, of course. UM has a job placement service," I said, slipping my certificate back into my tote. "I'll be working in no time."
"Cool,"
Marcy threw both arms around me. "Way cool," I said, and hugged her back.
"What's so cool?"
A man's voice spoke from beside us. I whirled and saw Ty Cameron, my official boyfriend, standing on the sidewalk. His office was nearby, so I figured he was heading out for lunch. My stomach did its usual flip-flop, just like always when I saw Ty. He was so handsome. Tall, light brown hair, gorgeous blue eyes, athletic build. He looked great in his suit. Ty was the fifth generation of his family to be completely devoted to, out of his mind dedicated to, and unreasonably consumed with, running the Holtz department stores. Yes, the same chain of stores that paid me a whopping $7 an hour. Long story. Anyway, Ty wasn't content with the dozens of stores the family owned. He'd recently opened a boutique he'd named Wallace, after some ancient Cameron ancestor, and he'd just concluded negotiations for Holt International. At least, I think it's concluded. I usually drifted off when Ty talked about business. Ty and I had dated since last fall. We'd had a few rough patches. Okay, more than a few. But we were doing great now. Well, good. Kind of good. Ty thought I should be more understanding about his duties and responsibilities to the Holtz Corporation. I thought he should actually remember our dates, show up on time, and not spend the entire evening texting or phoning somebody because of some problem at Holtz. Call me crazy. Anyway, we were trying to work it out, although I didn't think it would kill Ty to put a little more effort into it.
What is it?
Ty asked, smiling and waiting for an answer.
What's so cool?
Haley graduated from UM, Marcy exclaimed. I'd never gotten around to telling Ty I was going to bartending school. Not that he'd have listened anyway. Ty's expression morphed into disbelief, then to surprise, and finally into a smile again.
You graduated from college? Already?
Ty asked. Oh, crap. Ty knew I'd been taking classes to earn my bachelor's degree. Now he thought I'd done it.
Why didn't you tell me?
Ty asked. He threw his arms around me and pulled me into a big hug. He's so strong, and he always smells great. Ty's way hot. After a few seconds, I eased back a little. Well, really, it's not. Get a room, you two, someone said. I glanced around and saw Sarah Covington walking up to join us. I hate Sarah Covington. Sarah was the vice president of marketing for Holtz. She wasn't much older than me and already had her BA and made a ton of money so she could buy fabulous clothes and terrific handbags, which was reason enough to hate her. But she was all over Ty all the time. She was forever calling him about every tiny decision, every problem, every situation that came up. And the worst part was that Ty didn't get it. He thought the world rotated around Sarah Covington. I snuggled closer to Ty and threw Sarah an "I'm being a bitch by pretending to like you" smile and said, "Maybe we'll do that." Ty, of course, missed the whole exchange.
"Great news," he said. "Haley just graduated from UM."
Sarah's eyes widened in surprise. "The University of Michigan?" "The University of what?" "They have a fabulous online program," she said. What the heck was she talking about? "A friend of mine graduated from UM. It's very demanding." "Quite an accomplishment," Sarah said. "Congratulations, Haley." She said it like she really meant it, which just made me hate her more. "Was your degree in business?" Sarah asked. Oh my God, she actually thought I'd graduated from the University of Michigan.
"Of course,"
Ty said, smiling down at me.
"Right, Haley?"
Oh my God, Ty thought so too. Geez, what could I say? I couldn't announce that I'd really graduated from the University of Mixology, and that up until a couple of minutes ago, I didn't even know Michigan had a university. I'm not even sure where Michigan is. I'd look like a complete idiot and a total loser. Ty would be embarrassed. And that witch, Sarah Covington, would probably post it on her Facebook page quicker than Macy's took a season-end markdown. So, what could I do but smile up at Ty and say, "Yes, that's right." Thank goodness Ty didn't mention my graduation again. But it did kind of irk me. I mean, come on, For all he knew, I really had graduated from the University of Michigan's demanding online program. But he did ask me out to dinner a few days later and told me to dress to impress, like I ever dressed any other way, and picked me up early.
"Look at this,"
he said as he stood in my living room, dressed in a gorgeous Perry Ellis suit, crisp white shirt, and azure blue necktie that reminded me of the Caribbean, which I hoped he'd take me to one day, but knew he wouldn't, unless Holtz had a conference or something there. Ty pulled out his cell phone, held it up, and made a show of switching it off.
"No calls tonight,"
he said. Oh my God, I could hardly believe it. Ty had never switched off his phone before.
"You do the same," Ty said. "I want it to be just you and me tonight."
For a moment, I was too stunned to move. Sort of like when you spot the latest Chloe bag in a display case and hadn't thought it would be available for another few days. Finally, I came to my senses and slipped my cell phone out of my bag, a terrific Gucci clutch, and turned it off. It felt great knowing we were both free from every distraction tonight. Maybe our relationship was taking a giant leap forward. Ty drove us in his way-hot Porsche to the way-hot Hollywood Entertainment District. By day, thousands of tourists flocked to Hollywood and Highland to see the stars on the Walk of Fame, stick their feet into the concrete footprints outside Grauman's Chinese Theater, snap pics, and point to famous landmarks before hitting the great stores and shops. At night, the mood changed as the crowd shifted a few blocks east to take in a play at the Pantages or squeeze into the trendy bars and restaurants.
"Let's have a drink before dinner,"
Ty suggested, as he left his Porsche with the valet in front of the totally hip W Hotel. At the rooftop lounge, we ordered wine and relaxed on white overstuffed couches surrounded by lanterns and candles, potted palms and flowers. Soft music played in the background. Ty asked about my day, which was weird, and didn't tell me about his, which was even weirder. The sun went down and the lights of LA spread out around us like gleaming jewels on a Judith Lieber evening bag. Wow, I didn't know how the evening could get any more perfect.
"Ready for dinner?"
Ty asked as we finished up our third glass of wine. We held hands as we rode in the elevator. I hadn't been here before, but Ty must have been, because the maitre d' smiled pleasantly as we walked up.
"Everything is as you requested, Mr. Cameron, in our private dining room,"
he said. Ty hooked my arm through his as we walked down the corridor to the dining room. Inside, the lights were low, candles burned, flowers were everywhere. All the tables were already filled and, oh my God, my mom and dad were there. How weird was that? Then I spotted my sister and her boyfriend sitting nearby. Wow, what a coincidence. My gaze jumped from table to table. Ty's mom and dad were here, and so were his grandparents. I got a weird feeling in my stomach. At another table sat Marcy and some of our other friends. Then I saw a bunch of my mom and dad's friends and more of our relatives. I got a really weird feeling now. I looked up at Ty. What the? Suddenly, the band at the opposite end of the dining room broke into a strange song. No way could you dance to it. It sounded more like a march, maybe, or a... Oh my God. Oh my God. It was that song that was always played at graduation ceremonies. Along one wall hung a huge banner that read, "Congratulations, Haley." Then two waiters wheeled in a giant cake with sparklers burning, decorated with a diploma and graduation cap on it. Everybody seated at the tables broke into applause. Oh, crap. Chapter 2. Why didn't you call me? I all but screamed at Marcy.
Shh,
she hissed. We were in the ladies' room where I'd dashed as soon as Ty finished his speech about how proud everybody was of my graduation from UM. And he didn't mean University of Mixology. And the applause had died down. Marcy had followed, as a best friend would. I glanced around and didn't see any of my friends or family, then said, I can't believe you didn't warn me. I didn't know what was going on until I got here, Marcy told me. Ty kept it a secret. You should have called me as soon as you found out, I insisted. I tried a million times. You didn't pick up, Marcy said. So that was why Ty wanted us to turn off our phones. Am I an idiot or what? He didn't want the evening to be about just us. He knew Marcy would call me and ruin his surprise party. You can't let everyone think you got your BA from Michigan when you really didn't, Marcy said. You have to tell them the truth. Marcy was almost always right, but not this time. No way. No way, I said. Ty would look like a complete idiot, and so would everybody else who showed up here tonight. And I would look like the biggest idiot of all. What are you going to tell people when they discover the truth? Marcy asked. Nobody is going to find out. Jeez, I really hope nobody is going to find out. Haley. Everybody in that room thinks you just earned a business degree, Marcy said, sounding way too sensible to suit me at the moment. What are they going to think when you get a job bartending? I'll tell them I plan to open a bar and that I'm doing research. Marcy didn't say anything, and I could see she was thinking it over. You can't accept the gifts, she said. Gifts? There were gifts? It wouldn't be right, Marcy said. The image of a table sitting near the buffet, piled high with beautifully wrapped gifts, surfaced in my mind. They hadn't even registered when I'd walked in. That's how upsetting this whole thing was. Then a fantastic thought zapped my brain. Maybe one of them was the temptress handbag. Oh, wow. That would be so cool. It was the it bag of the season. Well, the moment, anyway. My spirits lifted as the image of that gorgeous bag floated through my mind. I'd seen it in all the fashion magazines this month. Getting that bag would be the saving grace to this whole ordeal. Haley, Marcy called my name in that sing-song way she has, the one she uses when she thinks I need to be reeled in. I hate being reeled in. I can't refuse the gifts. Everybody would know something was up if I did, I said. Trust me, after tonight, nobody is going to remember whether I have a college degree or not. Why would they? We walked out of the restroom together, and I spotted Ty waiting. Beyond him, down the corridor, I heard the murmur of my friends and family in the dining room.
I have a great surprise, he said.
Jeez, I didn't think I could take another of his surprises tonight.
Haley, now that you have your BA, I want you to come to work at the Holtz corporate office, Ty said.
I stopped, too stunned to move. Ty wanted me to come to work at the Holtz corporate office? In the same building where he worked? Where I could see him every day. And we could have lunch together and drinks after work. And everybody would know I was his girlfriend and be jealous. I mean, it's not like I didn't have mad skills. Last year, I'd worked for the Pike Warner Law Firm. Long story, so I knew all about the corporate environment. I was great at delegating and dressing for success, not to mention disseminating office gossip. Oh, Ty, that would be awesome. I threw myself against him and wrapped my arms around his neck. Hey, you two, get a room, I heard someone say. I turned and saw Sarah Covington standing in the hallway watching us. What the heck was she doing here? I hate her. This was my party. Who invited her? Damn, it must have been Ty.
I was just telling Haley how I want her to come to work at the corporate office,
Ty said. Oh? The word just hung there, like a loose button on a YSL skirt, annoying and sure to cause trouble at some point.
Ty, could I speak with you for a moment? Sarah asked.
She turned and walked down the corridor. Ty followed. At the end of the hallway, he leaned down and listened while she talked, and talked, and talked, and talked. Jeez, did she ever shut up? Finally, Ty nodded, and the two of them walked back.
Sarah has a good point, Ty said. It would look bad if you came to work at the corporate office since we're involved.
What? Sarah had told Ty I shouldn't come to work with him? And he'd gone along with it? I hate her.
But don't worry, Haley, Sarah said. After I learned that you'd graduated, I took the liberty of speaking with a friend of mine who works for a wonderful company. I've arranged an interview for you. It's tomorrow. Just a formality, really. I put in a good word for you.
Isn't that great, Haley?
Ty said. Oh my God. How could I refuse with them double-teaming me?
Yeah, that's really great, Sarah, I said.
Bitch. It was a Louis Vuitton day. Definitely a Louis Vuitton day. I parked in the lot off Fig and made my way up the block to the bank building where Marcy worked. It was a gorgeous Southern California day. Lots of sunshine, warm breezes, swaying palms. I was meeting her for lunch before my interview with the company Sarah had set me up with. I was still way too ticked off over the whole thing, but I hadn't been able to confront Ty about it last night after he'd thrown that graduation party for me. Not that he'd have listened anyway. It was lunchtime and the sidewalks were crowded. I spotted Marcy and waved as she walked out of the bank building. She waved back. Marcy was the best BFF ever. I wouldn't have made it through last night and this morning without her. She'd kept me from putting the smack down on Sarah Covington for sabotaging my chance to work with Ty at the Holtz corporate office. Then, this morning, she'd called early and made sure I updated my resume and emailed it to the Human Resources Department. She asked what I intended to wear, of course. Awesome, Marcy declared as she took in the black Michael Kors suit I had on. It was a relic from a bygone era, way back last fall when I'd worked at Pike Warner. I styled it this morning with a power red scarf and 3-inch heels and teamed them with my Louis Vuitton bag so the gals in HR would know up front who they were dealing with. That really was a killer party Ty threw for you last night, Marcy said, as we made our way up the street. Yeah, I guess, I said. It was, even though Ty had probably had his personal assistant find a venue, select the menu, arrange for the band, contact all my friends and family and swear them to secrecy. He'd at least thought of it. Plus, he'd actually been there. Not something that always happens with our dates.
You're still ticked off about the job, aren't you? Marcy said.
Not that I blame you, of course.
I need a Starbucks, I said.
Marcy frowned. What about your new lifestyle? No more frappuccinos. I threw her a not even a best friend could stop me now look. She interpreted immediately and crossed at the corner with me.
So, what's the story on the company Sarah set you up with? Marcy asked, as we went inside Starbucks and got in line.
Last night, I'd been majorly ticked at Ty for letting Sarah derail my employment at the Holtz corporate office. She'd blabbed on and on about the company.
I'd drifted off, picturing her as a rag doll and me sticking pins in her. Some place called Dempsey Roland, I said. I looked them up on the internet this morning. Marcy thought for a minute. Never heard of them. What do they do? I have no idea, I said. I just looked up their address. I can't take a whole hour for lunch today, Marcy said. Let's just grab something here. We got sandwiches, and I ordered a venti mocha frappuccino with extra whipped cream and a double shot of chocolate. That's how upset I was about this whole job thing. And found a table by the window. Look on the bright side, Marcy said. I didn't want to look on the bright side. I was in no mood. You'll make a lot of money, she said. Wow, I would. I'd been so upset about Ty caving to Sarah's wishes, again. I hadn't even thought about that. My spirits lifted a little. Plus, you'll need all new clothes, Marcy said. We can go shopping. My spirits lifted a little higher. And? Marcy said. She leaned in a little, so I knew this was going to be something great. You can quit your job at Holtz. I shot straight up in my chair. My eyes bugged out. My mouth flew open. I grabbed the sides of the table to keep from launching myself into the ceiling. You're right! I think I yelled that. Oh my God, how could I have been so upset over Sarah Covington that I hadn't realized what the new job really meant? I've seriously got to get a hold on my life. Then, my future rolled out in front of me like models streaming down a Milan runway. No more crappy sales clerk job. No more annoying customers. No more unreasonable store management. My own desk. A huge salary. New clothes whenever I want them. Fabulous new handbags. Oh my God, I could get that awesome temptress bag. I could get a new car. A BMW. I could move to a bigger apartment. Or maybe buy a condo near the beach. I could actually tell my mom where I worked and she'd be proud of me. Oh my God. Oh my God. I've got to go, I said, jumping up from my chair. I wanted to be early, way early, for my interview, to show them how conscientious I was, how dedicated I'd be, and what a perfect employee I'd make. And besides, I needed to brush up on my resume and remember what I'd put on it. Yeah, okay, I'd stretch the truth a bit, but who doesn't? It's expected, really. Good luck, Marcy called as I slurped down the last of my frappuccino and ran out the door. By the time I got to the office building, I'd spent my first three paychecks in my head. No need to rehearse my take this job and shove it speech for the manager of the Holtz store. I'd had it down since the second hour of the very first day I'd worked there. The Dempsey Roland Company was located in a high-rise building on Figueroa Street, just a couple of blocks from the bank building where Marcy worked and the Holtz offices where Ty worked. Great location for coordinating future lunches. The lobby looked sleek and contemporary, with lots of polished black marble on the floor and walls, and several chic-looking water features. I dashed into the restroom, checked my hair. I'd gone with a conservative updo that screamed, "Take me seriously," and freshened my makeup. I checked my phone. Ty hadn't called or texted. Geez, you'd think he would on a big occasion like this. I was his official girlfriend, after all. I went into the lobby again. Two guards in gray uniforms sat behind a big reception desk. I gave my name. One guy checked the computer while the other one eyed me, which was kind of weird. Then finally, I got a badge with visitor on it, which I clipped to the lapel of my suit jacket. Not a favorite fashion accessory of mine, but what could I do? I took the elevator up to the fifth floor. The doors opened, and a woman in a navy blue business suit approached as I stepped out. She was in her 50s, I guessed, neat, clean, and composed. "Miss Randolph, I'm Adela Crosby, Human Resources," she said, smiling. "Please follow me." Oh, wow, this was so cool. I had a personal escort. They must have had a really important position in mind for me. My annual salary grew larger in my head. Adela made small talk as we wound through a maze of offices. Dempsey Roland looked prosperous and sort of old school. Thick beige carpet, dark wood furniture, oil paintings of fox hunts and sailing ships on the walls. Everybody I saw seated in their offices or walking the corridor was well-dressed. I couldn't wait to go shopping for new business clothes. Marcy would probably go with me tonight. I'd get the new Temptress bag. Oh yeah, what an awesome way to start a new job. "Please be seated," Adela said as she led the way into her office. Atop her desk was a file folder with my name on it. We both sat down. I was mega nervous. I really wanted to work here. Not that I knew what they did or anything. So I forced myself to sit still and pay attention. See how I'm already dedicated to this company? "I'm looking at your job history," Adela said, flipping pages in my folder. A knot the size of a Prada satchel jerked in my stomach. Yeah, okay. I'd changed jobs a few times. Lifeguard, receptionist, file clerk, and 2 weeks at a pet store. But that was before I found my niche at Pike Warner last fall. A bigger knot jerked in my stomach. Things hadn't worked out as well as I would have liked at Pike Warner. There was that whole administrative leave, investigation pending thing. But it had all turned out okay in the end. Sort of. "You're currently employed at Holt's Department Store." "A retail job isn't easy," Adela said. "I can see you're a very hard worker. We like that here at Dempsey Roland." I relaxed a little. "And you've just graduated from the University of Michigan?" she asked. I tensed up again. "Quite an accomplishment," Adela said, still studying my file. "And I can see you come very highly recommended." I guess the recommendation came from someone at the company, by way of Sarah Covington. Wow, she had really hooked me up with a great job. I still hate her, of course. A couple more minutes dragged by, then Adela closed my file and folded her hands. "Mr. Thrasher heads up our human resources department," she said. "He's out of the office for a while, so I'm going to offer you a position in our contracting department." What the heck was a contracting department? "How does that sound?" she asked. I had no idea what sort of position that would be and what it would entail. I'd never heard of a contracting department, let alone had a clue of what it did. So what could I say but, "Great. It will be a full-time position," Adela said. My heart fluttered a little. A full-time position meant full-time pay. "With benefits, of course," she said. "Medical, dental, retirement, everything." Oh my God. "We'd like to start you out at $70,000 per year," Adela said. Oh my God. Adela gazed across the desk at me. I could see that she was talking, but I wasn't listening. How could I? Thoughts were pinging around in my head like waistband buttons at a chili cook-off. Then I realized Adela had finally stopped talking and was looking at me kind of funny. Jeez, had she just asked me a question or something? I didn't want her to think I wasn't paying attention, which I wasn't, of course. But still. Instantly, I channeled my mom's "I'm better than you" attitude. Mom's a former beauty queen, really. On rare instances, like solar eclipses and now, something she taught me paid off. I downgraded Mom's "I'm better than you look" to my own "I'm giving your words careful consideration" look. I found if I hold it long enough, the other person will eventually say something. Jeez, I wish Adela would say something. If you'd like to think over our offer and review the new hire package, that's fine, she said. Yikes, she thought I was reluctant to accept the job here. Quickly, I morphed my expression into my "I've suddenly made up my mind" look. Everything sounds perfect, I said, and managed to sit still when I really wanted to do a backflip off her desk. Excellent. Adela pulled a big folder from her desk drawer and passed it to me. I'm so glad you could come in today because we've got several other new hires going through orientation. We'll put you in with them, and you can start working tomorrow. My heart hammered in my chest as I walked the corridor with Adela. She was gesturing and explaining which department was which, where things were, who worked where. At least, I guess that's what she was saying. I drifted off. All I could think was that I could stop by the Holt store on my way home and quit my job. I'd call Marcy right away and give her the news. We'd have to go shopping immediately. Maybe she could leave work early today. I'd go by Ty's office and tell him. He'd be so happy for me. As long as I wasn't interrupting a meeting, of course. Adela led the way into a large conference room. Two men and a woman, all dressed in "please hire me" suits, were seated at the table clutching the same big folder as me. I took the chair farthest from the front of the room. Old habit. A woman stood at the head of the conference table, pulling a screen down from the ceiling. My spirits dipped a little. Apparently, we were in for the Dempsey Roland version of Death by PowerPoint. Adela introduced me to the other new hires, then gestured to the woman at the front of the room. This is Violet Hamilton. Violet heads up our security department, Adela said, then left the room. Violet looked kind of old to head up much of anything. She was a tiny woman, barely 5'3". And I doubted she weighed much more than the last pair of thigh-high boots I'd bought. Her snow-white hair was styled in an I-never-got-over-the-50s helmet, and she had on a bright pink suit. She looked like retirement home Barbie. But maybe she had a little new millennium Barbie in her. A laptop sat on the conference table near her. And perhaps she also had some I'm-better-than-you Barbie in her, because a Burberry laptop case sat close by. Granted, it was an older style, a special line of pink and black accessories they'd trotted out a few years ago, but it was a designer label, and she was working it big time. I'd like to stress to each of you the importance of completing your paperwork, Violet said, gesturing to the folders we'd all been given. It's mandatory that you answer each and every question put to you. You will not receive your security clearance. And remember, you can't work for Dempsey Roland without it until your background investigation is done. Wait a minute. Security clearance? Background information? What the heck was she talking about?
How long does it take to get a clearance?
A man, whose name I'd already forgotten, seated next to me, asked. Maybe this was something Adela was talking about in her office.
There are different levels of clearances required for different positions here at Dempsey Roland, so the time necessary to complete the background investigation will vary from person to person. Weeks, sometimes. Months, occasionally, Violet said. We move as quickly as possible.
I started to get a weird feeling.
How far back does your investigation go?
The same man asked. My weird feeling got weirder.
Years, decades, back to childhood, Violet said. After all, we're handling sensitive work for the government of the United States. We can't have anyone working here whose past is questionable.
What exactly do you mean by questionable? I asked. Violet smiled kindly at me.
No need to worry, Miss Randolph. I can see you're a nice young lady. It's not as if you've ever been in trouble with the law, have you?
Did being a suspect in multiple murder investigations count?
Or been involved in any organized criminal activity? She asked.
Geez, did that include the guy from the Russian mafia who owed me a favor?
You've never been let go from a job under a cloud of suspicion, have you? Violet asked.
Well, there was that whole administrative leave, investigation pending thing from last fall. Would that be a problem?
And everything you stated on your resume is true, isn't it? She asked.
Kind of. Sort of. Well, except for that part about the University of Michigan. And, well, maybe a few other things. What could I say? Confess to everything? Now? Before I even got my first paycheck? No way. How would I explain it to Ty? And what would happen when Sarah Covington found out I got the boot because I couldn't get the security clearance? I'd never live it down.
Haley, Violet asked, is there something you'd like to tell me?
What could I say, but...
No, of course not.
Then you have nothing to worry about, Violet declared. Oh, crap.
Chapter 3.
Was I going to get fired today before I'd really even gotten to work here? The notion had plagued me all last night. I hadn't even gone shopping. And this morning, and had taken all the fun out of imagining how I'd blow my first paycheck on clothes and handbags. I hadn't even told Marcy about the whole security clearance thing. That's how upset I was about it. I left my Honda in the parking garage, took the elevator down to the Dempsey Roland lobby, and flashed the ID card I'd been issued yesterday at one of the guards at the reception desk, while the other guard gave me a serious stink eye. I hoisted my Burberry satchel higher, then took the elevator up to 5. I was early. I wanted to get my desk chair warm before they booted my butt out on the street. But so were other people. They looked happy and secure, as if they'd actually still have their jobs at the end of the day. Geez, I really hope I still have my job at the end of the day. Yesterday, after several grueling hours of orientation and having us complete our background information forms, Violet Hamilton had given the 3 other new hires and me a tour of the office complex, then let us leave for the day. She'd left instructions for us to report to HR this morning, so Adela could escort us to meet our new supervisor, where we'd be given blah, blah, blah. I don't know what she said. I drifted off. I moved along the corridors with the other employees who'd reported early. Wow, a lot of people were already here. Some of them had a coffee cup in their hands. Others were already seated at their desks working. Wow, what was that all about? I couldn't help but notice that a lot of really good-looking men worked here. Not that I was interested, of course. After all, I had an official boyfriend who was fabulous. At least, he was the last time I heard from him, whenever that was. I turned a corner, then another, and another, looking for HR. It was like a maze in this place, and spotted the name Constance Addison on a little nameplate outside an office. Constance would be my supervisor, I recalled from a lucid moment during yesterday's orientation. A long, thin window ran down the edge of the door. I peered inside and saw the usual office furniture. Desk, shelves, chairs, computer, and a couple of big cabinets. The lights were off. No one was inside. I should have been doing my X-rated Snoopy dance. I'm pretty sure the upper management at Dempsey Roland frowned on that sort of thing, but it would be a hit at the office Christmas party if I lasted here that long. but instead, I was looking at the possibility of getting canned today. All because of that security clearance thing. With the exception of perhaps slightly misrepresenting my academic qualifications on my resume, which shouldn't be that big a deal if you ask me, I hadn't really done anything wrong or illegal or dishonest. Yeah, I'd been involved in a few questionable things, but none of them were my fault, really. So there was no reason to think I wouldn't get my security clearance and continue to work here, right? Besides, all that other stuff was in the past. I was starting over fresh in a new job at a new company. And as long as nothing bad happened here, I'd be fine, right? I glanced up and down the hallway and saw no one headed my way. Since I was lost and couldn't find the HR office, and I didn't want to look like a total idiot by asking, I decided I'd leave a little note for Constance, letting her know I was here, way early, and that I was reporting to HR. I opened her office door and walked inside. Huh, something smelled kind of gross in here. I got a weird feeling. I noticed that the chair was pushed back from the desk, and that the stapler, pencil cup, and paper clips were strewn across the floor. My weird feeling got weirder. I walked farther into the office and circled behind the desk. Violet Hamilton lay face down on the floor. I knelt beside her. She was covered in blood. Dead. A scream pierced my left eardrum. I jumped up and saw a woman standing just inside the doorway, holding a totally fabulous Prada handbag and a cup of coffee. She was a little on the chunky side and had on an I-don't-own-a-full-length-mirror burnt orange suit. I figured her age for the wrong side of 50. Her auburn hair was cut in a short bob. Her mouth gaped open, and she looked like two flying saucers had just landed in her eye sockets.
Oh my God! My office! What did you do? What did you do? She shrieked.
So this was Constance Addison, my new supervisor. Jeez, do I know how to make a first impression or what? She kept screaming like a siren going off. If her voice got any more high-pitched, only dogs would be able to hear it.
Violet! Oh my God, Violet!
Constance lurched across the desk, spilling her coffee and knocking a stack of papers onto the floor. She gasped and turned back to me.
What have you done to Violet?
I considered bitch-slapping her, just to break her momentum, of course. But instead, I pulled my cell phone from my purse.
Gun!
Constance screamed, pointing at my phone.
Gun!
Maybe I should go ahead and slap her.
Don't kill me, please, she yelled.
I hit 911, gave my name and a brief rundown on the situation to the operator, and hung up, just as a bunch of other people rushed through the door. Some of them looked familiar, but I didn't know their names.
Oh my God, Constance yelled as she pointed to me. She killed Violet!
Everybody looked at me funny. Then they all started screaming and jostling for position, some trying to get inside the office, others stampeding toward the door. Constance staggered backward and collapsed into the visitor chair by the window. There is no easy way to handle people in this sort of situation. Believe me, I know. I've had experience. Maybe I should put that on my resume.
Quiet! Everybody quiet! I shouted and clapped my hands together.
A hush fell over the room. All eyes turned to me.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.